Hello and welcome to BioLessons to Go. I'm Mr. Dove and this is Using Pedigree Charts to Study Human Genetics. In order to study human genetics, it's not possible to carry out a control breeding experiment with humans as we do with animals, or as, for example, when Mendel controlled the breeding of his pea plants. Instead, we have to use the natural experiments that happen when people have children, and see what characteristics tend to run in families. For example, this is a pedigree for the inheritance of widow's peak, the hairline. So we have a widow's peak and a straight hairline, and we can see how that widow's peak gets passed down to this young lady here. So essentially, a pedigree is a family tree that shows the inheritance of a trait from one generation to the next. So it's a family tree that's tracing a trait from one generation to another. Here we've got eye color. If eye color was inherited simply with just like a dominant and a recessive allele, we could understand why this blue-eyed trait skips a generation and then shows up in the grandchildren, because it was carried by those parents and then passed down. There are many different uses for pedigrees. One way that you might have heard, like pedigree dog food, because pedigrees are associated oftentimes with animals, purebred animals, dogs, cats, horses. Animal breeders can use the pedigree to show what traits are found in their animal's family line, which is a very useful tool when you're breeding. Another way that pedigrees can be used is to show how a trait, a hereditary trait, is passed from one generation to the next. This is especially useful if that hereditary trait happens to be a disease that causes a major problem. A genetic counselor can use the pedigree chart to figure out the distribution of that trait and come up with the probability of it being passed down in that next generation. This here is a pedigree for a small portion of a pedigree of the family called the Blue People of Kentucky, the Fugit family. As a result of some consanguineous relationships, first cousins having offspring, a trait called methemoglobinemia occurred in their family, which resulted in kind of a blue hue in the skin of the individuals. People marrying into the Fugits could use the pedigree information to determine what the chances of that being passed down to the next generation. Now, pedigrees are made in a very straightforward way. Females are represented by a circle. Males are represented by a square. And then a horizontal line indicates a mating event, a marriage. The offspring are depicted by a vertical line being drawn from the marriage line, and then siblings are then connected. Now, if you happen to carry the trait of interest, then you will be shaded in. So it's going to be a shaded symbol if you have the trait of interest. Generations are indicated by using Roman numerals. This helps us to separate as we're talking about, like Roman numeral 1, we're talking about the first generation here. Roman numeral 4 would be the most recent generation. Individuals in each generation are going to be indicated by Arabic numbers. So we would have Roman numeral 1, 1, Roman numeral 1, 2. 2, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 2, 4, 2, 5, 2, 6, 2, 7. And so that way, if we don't know the people in question, we can refer to them based upon their position in the pedigree. So let's take a look at some examples of some pedigrees, a dominant pedigree and a recessive pedigree, so that we can show how they can be useful. So our first pedigree is for something called Marfan syndrome. Marfan syndrome is an example of an inherited disorder that can be followed in a pedigree. People that have Marfan syndrome have hyperelastic joints and long bones, among other features, and that in this pedigree, what we see is that both girls and boys can get it in equal amounts. So this means that it's not linked to inheritance of gender, so we say that it's autosomal, if it can be seen equally in males and females. The trait does not get hidden in any generation, so it's most likely a dominant trait. Now, to be able to work with the pedigree, the first thing we want to do is we want to figure out what letters we want to use for our alleles. So let's use a lowercase for the normal allele and our uppercase M for our Marfan syndrome. So anybody who does not express Marfan syndrome has got to be homozygous recessive, because otherwise if they had the dominant gene, they would be showing the trait. So anybody who is not showing the trait, we're going to say is double recessive, is homozygous recessive. So now each of the individuals that have it, we know that they definitely have at least one dominant allele, at least one. So anybody who has the trait must have at least one dominant allele. And then we can put a little dash mark, because at this point, we're not quite sure what each of them are going to have. Now, for number one, and this individual number one, and this individual number two, we know that they must be heterozygous for the trait. They must have a recessive allele. And the reason why we know that is because they have offspring which don't show Marfan syndrome. So they had to pass a recessive allele on. So we know that they must be heterozygous. So the remaining genotypes must be heterozygous, because if their parents, if they have Marfan syndrome, but their one parent doesn't, then the one parent is always going to be passing on that recessive allele. Now, albinism is a disorder in which people expressing albinism, they don't have pigmentation for their eyes and skin. As with the pedigree for Marfan syndrome, we don't see any gender-specific inheritance. Boys and girls seem to be getting it equally in each generation. But one place where it's different from Marfan's is that in some of the generations, the trait gets hidden, which tells us that most likely this is a recessive characteristic. So if you have albinism, what you're going to want to do is all of the ones that have albino, they're going to be homozygous recessive. So if you have albinism, you're going to be homozygous recessive. So what that tells us then is that in order for two people who are normal pigmented to have an albino child, that means that they both must have the albino gene in their genotype. So they must be heterozygous. They're not affected by albinism, but they're able to pass that down to the next generation. So anyone else in the pedigree who happens to be normal must have at least one dominant allele. And so we can, you know, fill that in, them in with just that one dominant allele. And then imagine, as we go back, we can try to figure out what that second allele is going to be. You know, depending upon their parentage, you know, we'll have to check that out. In order to determine the genotypes of the unknowns, we need to look at the pattern that is observed in our pedigree. For individuals 1 and 2, we know for certain the genotype of the father, because he is albino, he must be homozygous recessive. Unfortunately for the mother, she comes from a different family tree, and so we know she's normal, but we're not too certain about her other allele. But when we look at the offspring, some of the offspring are albino. That tells us that she must be heterozygous, because she had to be able to pass that allele down to the next generation. She gave the dominant gene to two of her children, So they must be heterozygous as well, because the father, who is albino, must give the albino allele. When we look at the other side of our pedigree, once again, we know the mom's genotype, but we can't be too certain about the father's genotype because he's coming from a different family tree. When you look at the offspring, they all appear completely normal. They have no trace of albino. That means that the father had to give the dominant allele to all of his children. And of course, the mother must have given the recessive allele to the children, meaning that every child is going to be heterozygous. The father could be homozygous dominant, or he could be heterozygous. Based upon the pattern that we see, though, we can be pretty confident that he's homozygous dominant because he did not pass the recessive allele to the next generation. In a recessive pedigree, individuals that appear normal but can pass the recessive allele to the next generation are known as carriers because they carry the trait, they don't show it themselves. So, a carrier is basically another way to refer to someone who is heterozygous because they are showing one phenotype, but they're carrying the one that we are exploring. They're carrying that trait. So pedigrees can be a useful tool in tracing human traits from one generation to the next. Obviously, we can use pedigrees for any kind of animals or plants as a way to illustrate how alleles are passed from parent to offspring.